Hi, in this video we will see topics concerning rivers. In particular, a simple morphological classification will be highlighted. However, doubts will be left that can be clarified by those who have the appropriate knowledge. In fact, based on my knowledge, there are still no precise answers to behavior of some rivers. Here we have a picture of the Amendolea River in Calabria, Italy, with the ghost village of Rogudi. And in this other aerial picture, it's possible to see the Norman River in Queensland, Australia, that ends in the Carpentaria Gulf. A very simple classification comes from Leopold and Woolman. With reference to this draw, we have three kinds of river. The first one, the Strike River, here. Second one, the Meandering Rivers. And third one, the Bridle River. Strike river have a more or less straight path, and generally there is not island. Meandering river have a strongly tortuous path, but like the previous ones, they generally do not have island. Finally, the Bridle river have a path that is characterized by canals that intertwine with each other, resulting in the formation of island. Before starting a short trip around the world to see the path of some rivers, I show you another simple morphological classification. In fact, rivers can be even classified according to their riverbed. We have a river with a fixed riverbed, whereas this one in the picture, where the flow always takes place within the same fall. Or river with a moving or mobile riverbed, where the river has the possibility of digressing within a certain area that constitutes its floating plain. In fixed riverbed, the erosion is greater than the sedimentation capacity, so the river is not able to create a floating plain or to fill the valley where it runs. As an example of fixed or steady riverbed, I can take the Apurimac River near Cuzco in Peru. That is the upper leg of Amazonas River, and that has its spring only 160 kilometers from the Pacific Ocean, but it releases its water in the opposite side, in the Atlantic Ocean, after a journey of 7,000 kilometers. As it's possible to see, the river flows at the bottom of a deep valley, and its velocity is so high that the sedimentation is impossible. So mainly only the erosion is present, and the river has the possibility to dig more and more to the bottom of its riverbed. But we have a 3D view. Okay. Here there is the Apurimac River that runs at the bottom of this valley. Let we travel now to Brazil, to Amazonas basin, to apply the previous classification to some real rivers. Here we have This one, the Amazonas River, the longest one on the planet, 7,000 kilometers long, that has a more mainly bridle path, as well as the Madeira River. Here we have the Madeira River. In reverse, the Purus River, this one, and the Urua River, this one, have a meandering path. It is possible to observe a detail of the Urua River with the ancient meander that mean the wandering of the river in its flooding plain. But for instance, why does the Purus River has a meandering path and the Madeira River, that is just a little bit more than 100 kilometer far, has a bridle path? Here we can, as it's possible to see, the distance between the two rivers in this point is just a little bit more 100 kilometers. Let we compare the hydraulic condition for the two rivers, in particular the hydraulic gradients. Oh, I forgot to add just one more thing before talking about hydraulics matters. In all rivers, Amazonas, Purus, Madeira, Urua, as well as in many others, one in the Amazonas basin, rivers have a mobile river beds. As is possible to see, for instance, here on the Havari River. This one is the Havari River. That has a mobile riverbed because there is many ancient meanders that represent the ancient paths of the Havari River. Let me show you a 3D view. Okay, it's clearly possible to observe the ancient meander, and now we can see the border here between Brazil here, and here there is Peru. So it's possible to assert that the border between the two countries is not stable, of course. With reference to this figure, I now introduce the concept of hydraulic gradient applied to a river. Here we have a vertical section of a river. In green, there is the river bed. And the hydraulic gradient is just the ratio between the difference of altitude between the two points, A and B, and the length always between A and B. Now I check the hydraulic gradient of two different kind of river. For instance, I take the Madeira River here that has a bridled path, and the other one, the Urua River, that has clearly a meandering path. For instance, I take a distance of more or less 500 kilometers. And we have a difference of altitude that is more or less 120 minus 50. That is 75 meters over. Five hundred kilometers, changing in meters, of course. And we have a hydraulic gradient of 0.015. Okay. Now I take the Madeira River and I take again, more or less. A range of 500 kilometers. Okay. And we have a different latitude of about, here we have 50 meters. At the end, we can take more or less 15 meters. So 50 minus 15 is equal 35 over 500 kilometers. Expressing meter, of course. The hydraulic gradient is more or less 0.007. So I can say that the hydraulic gradient of the two rivers is almost the same. There is not a great difference. Anyway, the Urua hydraulic gradient is twice that of the Madeira River, but the order of magnitude is the same. So the different paths could not be connected to this hydraulic parameter. Instead, a great difference is present as regards the average flow rates. In fact, the Madeira River has a flow that is more than three times greater than those of the Purus and Urua, as it is possible to see in this summary table. We have the Madeira River that has an average flow of more than 30,000 cubic meter per second, and the Urua River has an average flow of more than 8,000 cubic meter per second, and the biggest one, the Amazon River, has an average flow of more than 200,000 cubic meter per second. I have not been able to find a clear answer from the hydraulic point of view on why especially meandering rivers choose a so complicated path. In fact, for their flow, they choose a path that appears to be in contrast with the law of hydraulics. The water, which does not want to make much effort in its movement, chooses the shortest path, other things being equal. Let me show you a last example. In this example, I take the Ucayali River that's run in Peru. And in this case, it's possible to see that the river has a meandering path, but many meanders present two channels. And so I can say that we are in a situation of transition between the meandering situation and the bridged situation. Anyway, I think that hydraulic arms on wide river are meandering or bridle or strake could be found in Schumm classification. Here we have a scheme of the classification of Schumm, which links the type of path of the rivers also to the type of solid transport. So the questions concerning the type of solid river transport must probably be added to the hydraulic issue: suspended load, bed load, or mixed load. In conclusion, I would like to add that hydraulic sewers include additional aspects besides the hydraulic gradient. In fact, the speed of water in a river, and therefore the flow, also depend on other parameters. For example, with reference to the Manning formula, the speed also depends on the hydraulic radius, as well as on the roughness coefficient. Ultimately, we are dealing with a fairly complex problem. I hope in the future to find a complete answer on the behavior of the types of the river that we have seen, and so to be able to say more about this fascinating aspect of river dynamics.